Good evening, I'm Shri Nanyan, coordinator of extramural lectures, and I will be your host for today. IIT Madras is honored to host winner of the Nobel Prize, the incredible Mr. Kailash Satyarthi and Mrs. Sumedha Kailash. Mr. Kailash Satyarthi was born in Vidisha, Madhya Pradesh, and went on to complete his degree in electrical engineering. He worked as a teacher and then left his job to start Bachpan Bachao Andolan, which has freed over 80,000 children from slave-like conditions. In 1998, Mr. Satyarthi conceived and led the global march against child labor, traversing across 103 countries, covering 80,000 kilometers, which eventually led to the adoption of the International Labor Organization Convention on the Worst Forms of Child Labor. Mr. Satyarthi established Goodweave International, dedicated to ending illegal child labor in the rug-making industry. He also operated a campaign in Europe and the United States on the issues relating to accountability of global corporations with regard to socially responsible consumerism. He was awarded the Nobel Prize in 2014 for the struggle against the suppression of children and young people and for the right of all children to education. Mr. Satyarthi is the first natural-born Indian Nobel Peace Laureate. Esteemed members of the faculty and dear students, please rise to welcome our chief guest, Nobel Peace Laureate, Mr. Kailash Satyarthi and Mrs. Sumedha Kailash. I now invite the Honorable Mr. Kailash Satyarthi, Mrs. Sumedha Kailash, Professor A.K. Mishra, our faculty advisor, Professor Preeti Aghalyam, and Student General Secretary Kushal to light the lamp.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Ajmal Hussain, the institutional head of the extramural lecture series for the year 2019-20. The extramural lecture series is the flagship lecture series of IIT Madras, which was launched in the early 1980s by a group of enterprising students with strong encouragement and support of the institute. The EML series serves as a platform for the institute community to interact with and learn from highly accomplished and reputed speakers from diverse backgrounds. In the past, our students and campus community have gained significantly from the EML series by being fortunate enough to host many eminent personalities like His Holiness the Dalai Lama, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, Ilayaraja, Dr. Muhammad Yunus, Vishwanathan Anand, S.S. Rajamouli, Jeffrey Archer, Eleanor Catton, and Padma Subramanian, among many others. The EML sessions are in the form of interactive lectures, debates, and discussions around topics concerning science, arts, culture, and society. Many new initiatives have also been introduced in the past, such as the EML Vernacular Series, the EML Social, and the EML Omnibus to expand and increase the scope of EML. The series goes down as one of the most memorable ones for the student community for inspiration and insights drawn from the interaction with most distinguished speakers. We at EML are honored to flag off this year's lectures with one of the world's pioneering figures in children's rights and India's pride, Nobel Peace Laureate, Mr. Kailash Satyarthi. I hope this year's series of EML lectures has a bright start, having begun with such an eminent personality like Shri Satyarthi. I am humbled and honored to welcome Mr. Satyarthi, his wife, Mrs. Sumedha Kailash, and the incredible team from Bachpan Bachao Andolan to EML and to IIT Madras. Next, I would like to welcome our beloved Dean of Academic Courses, Professor A.K. Mishra, and EML's faculty advisor, Professor Preeti Agalyam, without whom EML would not be possible. Thank you for your unwavering support and welcome to today's gathering. I would now like to welcome all the esteemed members of the faculty to today's lecture. I also extend a warm welcome to all the members of the student body who have gathered here. We hope you have a great show and take away a lot from today's lecture. Let this day mark another milestone in the history of the EML lecture series. I now invite Shri Kailash Satyarthi to address the gathering.
I don't think that I am too old to sit and speak, but I'm ready to just walk and talk to you for an hour or so. I think 30 minutes, an hour? Okay, thank you. What a great day. This hall is illuminated with some of the brightest young people of our country. I always had a dream when I was studying in high school and high secondary in my hometown in Vidisha to go to IIT. That was expensive, that was difficult back in early 70s. So finally I had to make a compromise and I started studying in Bhopal University. But perhaps you know that I studied engineering like you, and one day I became an electrical engineer. So whenever I am here with the engineering students, I said yesterday also, I feel at home. I feel more comfortable. And it also reminds me my old age. I knew that some of you have just joined this year or this month, last month. How many of you are newcomers this year in this session? Oh, all of you. Or almost all of you. Wonderful. But the days have changed. When I was there in the first event in my college in Madhya Pradesh, the first month of, I think it was also July, I was very nervous, sitting like that. Also, I was frightened with my seniors who used to do ragging, bad ragging. I think those days are gone in the country. But I could recall. I just learned that in last few years in this series, two Nobel laureates have already came and addressed my very good friend and brother Muhammad Yunus and the Holiness Dalai Lama, isn't? But for the newcomers, perhaps I am the first. You can enjoy then. But let me tell you one thing here. When I was a child, I had a dream. Professor Mishra and Professor Preeti, don't be confused that I had a dream to become a Nobel laureate, but I had a dream about Nobel Prize. Because I read about mainly the science laureates and some peace laureates. And my dream was that one day I will be able to meet and greet a Nobel laureate. I will shake hand. And the most important was that I wanted to have a photo, a picture with him or her, so that I can put everywhere in my room. So before that, I had some pictures of Swami Vivekanand and Mahatma Gandhi and Subhash Chandra Bose. Great people, Rabindranath Tagore. So my dream was that I should have a picture. But let me tell you the secret that I had to wait for 50 years to shake hand with a Nobel laureate. And that was the Dalai Lama. We were sharing a dais in Germany. And I was 55-year-old or 60, yeah. So I was looking sometimes at him, but I was also looking for a cameraman. And they allowed just one cameraman to come because of security reasons. He took pictures of Dalai Lama, and I was doing like that, but I can't do anything. I was sitting on the dais. I wanted to call him so that he can take my picture with the Holiness so that my dream would be fulfilled. But he left. And Dalai Lama asked me, "Young man, do you look like Indian? What are you looking for?" I did not say that I'm looking for a cameraman. I'm more interested in a cameraman, not in the Dalai Lama that time. So he was holding my hand for a few minutes. He thought that I'm becoming nervous. But I don't think that any engineer can be nervous. Meeting and greeting anyone in the world, we had to go through very difficult times for 4 years, 5 years, 6 years. So we learned to be smart. So I had no photo. Then in 2014, one day suddenly I got a call from a journalist. He was very excited. He said, "Kailash ji, Nobel Prize, Nobel Prize." He could not complete his full sentence. He was almost crying. And I thought that somebody might have got the Nobel Prize, and this man wanted to get some remark from me or some comment from me. And I did not want to be looked like a stupid person who had no idea that somebody has won the Nobel Prize that day. So I started Googling. I was sitting in my office, I Googled. And for a few seconds, so I was Googling not my name, that was out of question, Nobel Peace Prize 2014. And then, after a while, my name started appearing, and I could not believe. But one thing I remembered, that I wanted to have a photo with a Nobel laureate. So what to do? I immediately rushed to my washroom, stood in front of the mirror, and took at least 20 selfies. I told yesterday some of the young friends who were present yesterday, many of you. So, don't shy to take a selfie with me, I promised you yesterday. I'll keep my promise. Because for me, it took 50 years to take a selfie with a Nobel laureate, and it was me. But today we are talking about, no, it is not written in the back. Sometimes they put the subject on the background, or backdrop, what they call. But I can recall that it is compassion in youth. Is it true, Paromaji? Good. So you can see that I am not a monk or a saint who is going to talk in the conventional manner and explaining you or preaching you about compassion. No. So don't expect me a preaching. But as I said that I feel at home and I feel that I am amongst my young friends. So I'm going to share a few things with you based on my own life experience. Today everybody knows about the three-dimensional approach, three-dimensional audiovisual. 3D is a common factor now. Even the high school students know about it. But as a young person, I'm not still old, as I said before. So as a young person, I started learning 3Ds. My first D is dream. Today is the day when you are taking the first major step in your life about your career, about your dreams, about your aspirations, even about the aspirations and dreams of your parents and grandparents probably. So everybody should have a dream. But if God has given us a capacity to dream, why we should be meager in dreaming small things? If you dream small things, perhaps you can achieve that, you can achieve a little bit bigger, but you cannot be a person who shape or change the human history. So if you have that inbuilt capacity to dream, why don't you dream big, bigger, and biggest? You can dream to become an engineer. That is the easiest thing that is going to happen. But you can dream to see that what is going to happen in next 10, 12, 15 years. How the information technology will grow and how it is going to impact the society. How the artificial intelligence will grow and impact the world, the human minds. And sometimes overpower the emotional intelligence, the natural intelligence of human beings, the robotic sciences, the virtual media and whatnot, all kind of things, the space technology. So many things are going to happen in next 5-10 years when you stand as a strong engineer, professional educated engineer. So dream in such a way that how you are going to make an impact in the world in a positive manner. Those who dream for themselves, they can do, they can achieve, they can become billionaire. Not bad. You can dream to become a billionaire, not millionaire. But more important than that is to dream for others. Dream for your nation, dream for your world. Dream for entire humanity. My second D which I learned was discover. When you are able to dream big, biggest, don't stop there. How are you going to fulfill your dreams? If you do not discover your inner power, everybody is born with immense, immense capability, immense power. In some school of thoughts, people believe that you are the reflection of divinity, you are the reflection of God, every human being. So how God can be meager that she will give birth to someone who has very limited power? It is unlimited. So discover the inner power which is unlimited. Don't wait for others that they are going to give you power. We have just lit this lamp. And in the Vedas, the ancient book of wisdom in India, they say agninam agnihi samvidyate. The fire ignites more fire. So, discover that fire within you. There is a story in Upanishad. There was a guru, a teacher living in jungle. He became known to some people because he was very disciplined and highly devoted for his profession, for his teaching. Very learned person. So, the king of that region advised his son to go and learn from this guru. The prince said, why I have to go so far? This man could be brought here and he will teach me inside the palace. King said, no, it is not possible. You have to go. So, as usual, prince went with all his elephants and all kind of paraphernalia, all kind of things. So when he went there and knocked the door of that hut, the voice came from inside, who are you? He said, I am the prince of this area. I am the son of king. And he was hoping that the doors would be open in 1 minute, but it did not happen. He kept on waiting for a while and then he became very angry and he said, what are you doing? Why don't you open the door? No noise, no sound came from inside. Doors were not open. Angry prince went back to his father and complained. Father said, no son, you have to go back again. So after a few days, the boy came again without all these elephants and chariots and so on. He knocked the door. The guru asked, who are you? Then he didn't say that I am prince. He said, he told his name. Just his name. The doors were not opened. Prince went back and came again, was supposed to go again. And this time he knocked the door. And then This was the first day of his learning. "Who are you?" the guru asked. He said, "Sir, if I knew who am I would have not come. I am here to know who am I." And he studied there, and after some years, there was this valedictory function. The degrees were given. "That is going to happen one day with you." Then the guru asked him, "Who are you?" He said, "Sir, I am fire. I am light. I am going to ignite the whole world. This is me," he said. You are that fire, my dear young sisters and brothers, my dear young daughters and sons. You are that fire. You are fortunate enough to come to this institution because of your hard work, because of your parents' support, because of your teachers. Whosoever is responsible should be credited for this day that you are sitting here. When you go back, you have to ignite the world with this fire of IIT Madras. Can you do it? Can you discover the power inside you, and that would be shaped, that would be harnessed more and more by your gurus here, teachers here? Can you? That is discovered. But that is not enough. When you are able to discover the inner self, then you have to discover the opportunities outside. You have to enlist the challenges also, because the world will have new challenges. It is not all about jobs, it is more than that. The world is full of challenges, which you are not responsible for. But you have to figure out that what are the opportunities to fulfill your dreams, to channelize your inner power and energy. What are the external factors which will help you? You start finding those factors now. That will make you visionary. That will make you more strategic, a very good planner. And I said yesterday that if some people believe that young people are problems, they are absolutely wrong. Every young person is a solution, and especially the engineers are solutions, because you deal with the problems every day, every minute, in every lesson, and come out with some solution. So you are solution. You are solution. Be the solution to any complex problem of the world as an ITM. So the first one was, what was the first one? Very slow. Even on the first day when I was nervous in my college, I was a little bit naughtier. Dream. And the second one is? What could be the third one? Huh? Good idea. The third one is, if you can dream, if you can discover opportunities outside and inside, don't wait for others. No avatar, no Bhagwan, no incarnation is coming to solve the problems. You have to do. So the third is do. Act. So what are these three D's? Can you repeat? I cannot hear. I think girls have to be louder than boys. For 5,000 years, the girls have been taught, the mothers have been taught, the daughters have been taught, the sisters have been taught, the wives have been taught to either remain silent or to be shy or don't shout. Everybody says that you are going to be married one day, so behave properly and speak slowly, don't shout. Today, shout. Boys will remain silent now and all girls will shout, what are these three D's? What is the first D? No? You have to break the shackles of 5,000 years of this mindset. Shout loudly. Ek saath. All three. Dream. Again, two, three times. Let the boys listen to the voice of the young ladies. Good. Boys can do now. What are these three D's? The reason is that you are outnumbered, girls. So, I will share two stories. One was the very first day of my own schooling when I was 5 years old, 5 and a half. That has ignited that fire, that spark inside me. And the other story, what has given me the path of life, the purpose of life very clearly. So that clarity became conviction, consistency, courage, and so many other things. When I went to my school, I was quite excited. When I was entering there, I saw a cobbler boy sitting along with his father. And I could not forget that he did not look at us boys who were going to school, he was looking at our feet. Perhaps we can give him some job of shoe shining. But we were all wearing new shoes. So I was a little bit disappointed or disturbed. I asked my teacher, "Sir, why a child is sitting outside the school gate?" He was my age. Teacher said, "Calm down, this is your first day, make new friends. This is not uncommon, the poor children have to work and help the families." I could not say anything to him. I went back. I saw the boy still sitting there in the afternoon under the open sun. I asked my parents, my friends, everybody said that this is not uncommon. Every morning and afternoon I kept on watching this boy. I was becoming more and more impatient, and one day I gathered all my courage and went straight to the father and the boy. When I asked the same to him, he was shy. But his father was almost shocked. He stood up with folded hands. And you know the Indian caste system, in this caste hierarchy, 50 years ago, more than 50 years ago, the people were more, you know, timid and felt inferiority. So he said, the man said, Babuji, maine to kabhi ye socha nahi. I never thought about it. My father, my grandfather, and I started this work since we were children. And so is my son, he said. Then he took a little pause and said, Babuji, school jane ke liye to aap log hain. Hum to yehi mazduri karne ke liye paida hue hain. You guys are born to go to school, but we are born to work, he said. I had no answer, I had no idea at that age. I started crying badly. When I went back home, I was already crying. Nobody was giving me that answer, that why that child is working at the cost of childhood, freedom, education, future. I was very angry from inside. All my pain, all my inner suffering converted into anger. And I started thinking that whatever my teachers say, it's a complacency, it's a mindset which has been going on for years and years and centuries, generation after generation. Whatever my parents say may not be true. The truth is above these assumptions and these traditions and customs and caste. This bias or understanding and knowledge which has been just transferred from one to another generation. That does not stand on any measurement of righteousness and justice. I refuse to accept. I refuse to accept that day that any child is born at the cost of or forced to work at the cost of her freedom and education. And after half a century, I still refuse to accept this. Those eyes with utter misery, helplessness, helplessness, gave me a different perspective of life. I started looking at the world with a different eye, and I found that there were many children, girls and women are suffering. I found that some of my friends left schooling because their parents could not afford textbooks. They could not afford fees, school fees. I started collecting old books, used books. When I was 11 years old, I started collecting such books, and my teacher helped me to give it to needy children. We started collecting some money from our pocket money, out of her pocket money, so that they can get some support. But since I was I was scoring almost 100% marks in mathematics. If 99 come, then I feel bad. Sometimes it happens 99, 98, 97 in my primary, secondary school. And of course, in science, I was good. So obviously, my parents think that he is fit for engineering. So they put me to engineering. If I would have watched Three Idiots that time, I have not gone to engineering. But it does not mean you need not to leave IIT following Three Idiots. But if one of you can become an idiot, nothing is bad with that. But first graduate from here. So I graduated from there, and then I taught in the university, Bhopal University, for about 1.5 years. And I was specialized as high voltage transformer design engineer. Those days, that was the most or one of the most lucrative careers, because computers were not yet invented, at least in India. They were not there. Or this IT sector. And the new, so many new faculties are there now, but say 40, 50 years ago, 45 years ago, very limited. So I gave up my career one day, and it was quite a tough decision. Tough decision for me, tough decision for my parent, my mother, because I lost my father when I was young. And I don't come from a rich family. We were not though poor, but it was an ordinary Indian family. My father was a police constable. We were living in a kaccha house. My mother had to sell her ornaments for my higher studies. So it was impossible for me to convince her that why I am giving up my job and wanted to embark upon an issue which was a non-issue. I did not believe in conventional charity or kindness, that you become kind and, you know, feel pity for others and help others with your pocket money or with others. I learned that during my engineering, I learned many things, but one thing was that there are systemic problems and there are systemic consequences. And sometimes they make the vicious circle. So as a system engineer, I started finding the problem in a much deeper way. Why some children are born to work? Caste system, communalism, failure of law, or non-existence of appropriate laws, constitutional issues, economic issues, and so on. So I started writing in the newspapers about such issues related to children, women also, and trying to prove that this is not poverty. I challenged that preconceived notion that poverty is responsible for all kind of abuses and exploitation. There were other factors. And that was most difficult time, because the whole notion of child rights in the world, not only in India, but in the world, has not yet been properly established. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child was adopted by the international community, by the General Assembly, only in 1989. Almost a decade after I started working in 1980. So very tough time. So when I used to write on it, people laughed at me. They ignored me. Editors said that these arguments are not really based on research. There were no research. You can hardly see any newspaper article related to child slavery, child trafficking in 70s. Or even child rights. The phrases like child rights were not used. And I know that none of you were born that time. But I was your age, or a little bit elder than you. So I started my own magazine called Sangharsh Jari Rahega. The only person who was supported my idea, this crazy idea to fight against child slavery in the largest democracy of the world, was none other than Sumedha, my wife. So my mother kept on crying for days and years, because I was embarking upon on such issue, which was very dangerous, challenging mafias and traffickers and so on. So one day, a desperate father knocked my door, whose daughter was about to be sold to a brothel. His name was Vasil Khan. He was carrying an old copy of my magazine, and he came with only expectation that I am going to write something about his story. So I let him in my small room, started writing. And he was holding my feet and just crying and crying that, Babuji, meri beti ko bachalo, meri sabo ko bachalo. Save my daughter, he said. He was crying, pleading. And I was shocked to learn. I knew about all these problems, but not in so detail and so depth. 17 years ago, he and his newly married wife and some more people were trafficked, lured away from his native village from Aligarh to work at a brick kiln in Punjab. There is a place called Sarhind. And during those 17 years, none of these families were allowed to leave the place. They were not paid anything at all. All children were born and grew up there, including 15-year-old Sabo. And one day, the girl was called in the office of the brick kiln owner. There were some unknown people. They were from brothels, Delhi brothel. And they came to buy that girl. And the mother saw from the window, from the backside, that her private parts were touched as somebody was buying a cow or a buffalo. The slave master was asking for more money for this virgin girl, and the brothel keeper were not prepared to pay that much amount, so the deal was not materialized. Mother could not cry. Otherwise, she would have been beaten up, the whole family. They knew what would be the result. But somehow she told her husband. And the man had no option. He jumped into a brick-loaded truck in the middle of night when the truck was leaving for selling the bricks. The truck reached Chandigarh, the capital town of Punjab and Haryana. And he jumped out in the early morning and just knocking every single door, please save my daughter, please save my daughter. Coincidentally, he met a person who was the subscriber of my magazine. Sheer coincidence. This man told that, go to Kailash. He will help you, at least he will write your story, and perhaps the government department, police, somebody can help you if it is a published article. So with this expectation he came. And let me tell you that when I was writing, I started thinking that if Sabo was my daughter or my sister, what would I do? I don't believe in preaching. I am an angry man. I was angry that day. I thought that how could it be possible that my daughter or my sister is sold like that? I told Vasil Khan, I'm going to go with you to rescue your daughter. I won't let it happen. He said, Babuji, they will kill you and kill me. They are very rich, well-connected criminals. I said, no, I'll go. Went to my wife and requested her to give her wedding ornaments, to organize logistics like truck or... He said that there are about 30, 40 people, not just my family. So I called up some of my friends and collected them, requested them to go. Some of them agreed. So when we went to rescue them, we were beaten up. He was thrown away, Vasel was caught. He was badly beaten and attacked. So I had to come with my friends, empty hands, barefooted, torn clothes, but not with empty heart. I strongly believe, and I tell you, underline, no problem in a life, no problem on this earth is born without the solution in its womb itself. This is the characteristic of an engineer, that when you go into the deeper of that problem, you find better solutions, more effective solution, more sustainable solution. You need not to believe on those superstitions and other things. You have to believe in yourself and your problem-solving capacity. Engineering taught me that. So when I got back, I started looking for some way out, and I met a friend of mine who was a lawyer. He said, there is no law against child labor. The law against child labor was enacted only in 1986 in India. There were some old British provisions, but they were never used. He said, there is a way out under habeas corpus. There is another provision. So we went to the court with the help of that lawyer. And within few days, the court has given order. All those 36 children, women and men were brought before the court, and they were all liberated by the court. When I was bringing them back to my small one-room office, some of you are familiar with Delhi. Who has traveled to Delhi or come from Delhi? Raise your hands. Quite a lot. So there is an India Gate. So the High Court is close to India Gate. So when we were walking from High Court to India Gate to a place called Mandi House, it's a cultural center, my office was situated there. These girls and boys who were born in slavery, they have never seen cars, they have never seen houses, they have never imagined big roads. They were jumping on the street. They were jumping like the frogs were put forcibly into a bucket, and suddenly you open the cover of the bucket and they jump out. Mothers were crying in tears. Tears of joy, just to hold them. I'm holding hand of Sabo and a couple of other children, but even then they were jumping out of joy. I read the Indian freedom struggle. I knew about all the great sacrifices Indians made for independence from British. I have also read about moksha and mukti and incarnation and reincarnation and all those things. Philosophical interpretation of freedom and liberty. When I was an engineering student, this was also my hobby, to know more about the other issues. But that was the moment of truth for me. That was the day when I could feel God inside me. I could feel God on the faces of those mothers who were crying out of tears, out of joy. I could feel God on those smiling faces of young kids who were born in slavery but now trying to comprehend, trying to understand freedom. Since then, I never looked back. I don't know how many saints, priests, sadhus, maulvis, mullahs, fathers have experienced God or seen God. I'm sure, I hope so, some of them did. But I had never looked back since then. I am most fortunate person that by freeing more than 87,000 children from slavery, I have experienced God 87,000 times. What will you call it? I am a very ordinary person. Most Indians, let alone foreigners, had no idea who was Kailash Satyarthi when I got the Nobel Peace Prize. Pal Bhaskar is my old friend and he has been working in Tamil Nadu and rest of South India. So he knew, but most of the people have never heard my name. So the funniest thing happened that day on 10th of October 2014 was that for few seconds, two times on that day, which is rarest of the rare situation, the Google search engine was completely stopped. And after a few months, the Google founders invited me and Sumedha ji for a family camp. Their families were there, and Sundar Pichai was yet working under them. He was not yet CEO in 2015 or 2016, but Eric and all those people, because they wanted to introduce me with their children and their families who were more curious to learn about me being a friend of children. So I asked this question, that you founded Google and search engine, and what was your experience when your search engine was stopped because of my name? You should improvise it, I said. But that was fun. But what would you call this fight? I call it the journey of compassion. As a technocrat, I can also call it applied compassion. Compassion is not mercy, it is not just kindness, it is not sympathy. I said yesterday, answering one question, that it is not either empathy. It is the deepest and the most powerful spark, a gift God has given to us, every human being. Hindus, Muslims, Christians, this is all creations of human beings. These identities are just the fake artificial creations. God has not created any person, Hindu or Muslim. We did it. Or high caste and low caste and Indian and Pakistani and all kind of things. All these divisions. But what God has given us, two things. One is consciousness, that we are awakened when we are born. We cry, we move our hands and legs because of awareness. And our first connect with our mother is what? When you cry, your mother feel that cry inside her. Embrace you. The milk start coming. That is the first expression of or relation of compassion as a human being between the mother and child. Compassion is the feeling for suffering of others. any unknown person. Suffering of others as it is your own suffering, with a desire, with a drive, with a determination to solve that suffering. As you feel that this is your own suffering. That is the innermost spark inside you. So the growth of consciousness has a history in itself, and today we have reached to a stage of suicidal situation of global warming and climate change and whatnot, water crisis also in this town, in this city, everywhere in the world. Humanity will face these things, and we are looking for alternate sources of water, renewable energy and artificial intelligence. Because we have lost our grip, our understanding on other thing, and that is compassion. So the compassion, when you connect with someone with compassion, means you start feeling the suffering of others as your own suffering, so you don't do any mercy to anyone. It happens. As something goes wrong with you, you act automatically. I have been struggling to bring compassion in lives, not just on the issue of child labor or child trafficking or whatever. We started living in this age of knowledge and technology and consumerism, materialism, so many things. It is good if it is leading to the better quality of life. If the science and technology leads us to freedom, freedom of mind, that is the whole purpose. The journey of science is the journey of truth. Getting into deeper and deeper truth. But if it is manipulated only for the economic gains by certain people, science and technology, if it is converted only into the artificial consumerism, a fake consumerism, you don't need so many things, but you keep on buying those things because your mind is driven by advertising agencies and advertising technologies. We are losing the human connect. Our compassion is shrinking, and it remains confined to sometimes our own siblings, our own children, daughter, son, husband, wife. But let me also tell you that the world is suffering so many problems, psychological problems is one of them, loneliness, alienation, disconnect. We have never been connected so fast as we are connected through the modern technology. But that is so superficial connect that we cannot express ourselves deeply, and we cannot trust and believe people with each other. Husband and wife sitting in the same room and sending text messages, WhatsApp messages. It is almost free. But you can't share, because you are losing the confidence in yourself, and you are also losing the trust in your partners and your friends and relatives. Your circles are shrinking. So what a paradox, what a contradiction, that world is expanding in knowledge and technology, and the human minds and hearts are shrinking. And if you are disconnected, if you are lonely, then you are most unsafe. The connectivity brings safety. And the connectivity is possible through the truthfulness in your relationship. In my office, in my organization, sometimes the young people meet each other and they fall in love. And after a while, they think of marrying. One of them says, no, I'm not prepared to marry. It takes another year, 2 years, and then they break away. Sometimes they marry, but they can't stay together and come to us, to my wife and me, bhai sahab ji, kya kare? Hum baithte hain, samjhane ki koshish karte hain. Kal main keh raha tha, I was saying yesterday that the biggest growing, or one of the biggest growing business now is the business of these counselors, psychologists. Not only in India, but globally. Every third, fourth young professional says that I have to go to my counselor today to spend an hour or so. Why? Stressed. I'm stressed. I say that this is like a larger family. We live together, we laugh together, we play together. Sometimes I eat with them, and my also other senior officers treat them as friends. But even them, they are burned out sometimes. Says, no, sir, not because of work, because of other relations. So I tell them that this is because your connect with your partner is not the compassionate connect. This is the connect with expectation. This is the connect with some sort of appeasement, making others happy, behave like you are the most handsome person on the earth, the young people, or most kind person, but that kindness is not natural. So compassion gives you several skills. One skill to take initiative. It does not remain to your feelings, it drives you to take initiative to solve the problem of suffering of others. You have the same feeling as your partner have, your friend have. And if you try to solve that problem, you don't feel that you have done something special to her or to him. Some act of kindness, that is not the case. If you are injured by something, you go to a doctor or you try to treat it yourself, but you don't tell yourself that you have done mercy or an obligation to yourself. You did it because you feel it. So in the relationship, compassion matters a lot. I call for compassionate politics. What is the relationship between the ordinary people, the citizens, the voters, and the leader, the MLA, the MP, the minister? They are just votes. If you go to any of the political parties' office during the election time, they are very sophisticated now. The booth management, and every booth, they make a clear-cut record that how many Muslims, how many Hindus, how many Christians, how many Brahmins, how many lower caste, how many middle caste, this, that. Gupta, Jain, etc. And you talk to them. No one ever take the record that how many young people are struggling day in and day out for job. Nobody talks that how many fathers are selling their small things or their ornaments and their houses for the dowry of their daughters. Nobody talks that why the quality of education is so low in our schools. No, they talk of Hindus, Muslims, because their connectivity with those people are voters. And they have to get the vote. This is political connect. So I am talking about the politics with compassion. Day before yesterday, I was in Kolkata and addressing some of the top entrepreneurs, industrialists, corporate leaders. And I was calling for business with compassion. That gives the competitive advantage. If you do business with compassion, means you care for your stakeholders, you care for your investors, you care for your customers, you care for your workers, employees. The relationship between the president of the company and the last employee of the organization should be the relationship of compassion, that you start feeling the suffering of them and try to be the problem solver. Not with any ego that you are the problem solver, but it happens automatically, and that is the compassionate business model. So what we need in the world, dear friends, I can conclude here with a couple of other things. As I said before, that you are full of power. When you start dreaming, when you start discovering, when you start doing the things, then you need not to look for heroes outside. I met several heroes of different different languages, right from English to Hindi to Tamil, Bollywood. And sometimes they confess, Kailash ji, we know that we are just actors, doing actor. Most of you love Bollywood heroines and heroes, do you? And the players, of course. We have to have respect for them, for their art, for their skills, for their accomplishments. They can be our inspiration. They can be the role model if you really wanted to go into that job. They are the role models. But their determination, their sacrifice, is something which has to be learned from. But how they can be your hero? If somebody is doing an acting of touching the feet of his mother, an old lady, poor lady, and the hero comes and touches the feet, you become emotional. If a hero comes singing songs, the heroine is coming dancing from the other corner behind the tree, or now coming from the third floor in the lift, and suddenly they meet each other, then they kiss. Not the first time, after some days. Do they really love each other? Do they love each other? They are acting. They are acting love. They are acting respect for their mother and father. If they are doing something good, if they are fighting with villain who is doing wrongs to the society, their fight is fake acting and paid for every single sentence. If they touch the feet, they are paid. If the heroine is coming and hugging the man, she is paid highly. And the man is also paid highly. So this is the paid love. If you respect someone, do you respect your parents? How many of you respect your parents and teachers and elderly people, dada, dadi, nana, nani? All of you, all of you. You are a little bit shy. You love your wife but don't respect your parents. Is it, Professor? No, I'm just kidding. So you are a little shy, they are not. So I love something very special in them, that spark. Courage to laugh. Sometimes we shy in laughing. We are very shy in crying. You require a lot of courage when you cry, because it needs a lot of honesty. Anyway, you raised your hands. Some of you might be having or will have some boyfriends and girlfriends, or at least some friend, girl or boy. Does not mean in the conventional manner boyfriend or girlfriend. But I am sure that you are not directed by a director from the back that you have to do this. you have to smile like this. You smile automatically when you meet someone or greet someone. When you respect your parents, you are not paid for that. Neither a director says that you have to touch the feet of your parents. You do it. So who is the real actor? Not doing acting, but doing action. The truth action is done by the real hero. If you protect someone, if somebody is being, you know, being tortured, or somebody is being abused, or if somebody needs help and you do help, it's because there is a hero inside you. If you feel bad if something is going wrong around you, it's because there is a hero inside you. Don't wait for the heroes from the cinema screen. Find a hero inside you, because you are hero, you are hero, you are hero, you are hero. You are champions, you are change makers, you are leaders. Don't look for the leaders sitting in Chennai and in Delhi and Mumbai and other places, Kolkata. They are not the real leaders. The real leaders is inside you, because you are truthful. No change in the history was possible without the energy and fire of young people, without the passion and courage of young people. And that's why you have to assume that responsibility. You start acknowledging yourself that you are not only engineers to become in few years, but you are the change makers. In your own field, you are the heroes. And that's why I have launched a campaign called 100 million for 100 million. 100 million young people in the world are victims of slavery and trafficking. I come across the children in remote areas in Africa who are working in cocoa beans production, and the cocoa beans are the core ingredients of chocolate. All of you love chocolate. Most of the children, young people, love chocolate and give presents, chocolate. But when a child says to me that, though I have been working for 5 years in cocoa field, but I have never tasted chocolate. I've never seen chocolate. They have no idea what chocolate is, but they are working with injuries and scars on their bodies. I met those girls in India and Pakistan, girls and boys, 6, 7, 8 year old, stitching footballs. And sometimes when they make mistakes and the needle goes into their fingers, they suck the blood and kept on working because they are enslaved. One day when I asked to a girl in Pakistan that, my daughter, I make sure that tomorrow onwards you would not be working here, you would be freed. What is your dream? Khwab kya hai tumhara, maine pucha. She said, what is khwab? What is dream? I said, if some miracle happens in your life, what you want to be, what you want to see, what you want to do. She looked here and there and she did not answer. Then she smiled and said, if it happens, then I would like to hit a real football one day. She could not dream before even to play with a football. I freed children who were making carpets, but they cannot touch the carpet after finishing. They are not allowed to touch. I have come across many children whom we freed from slavery who were working in construction, in brick making, in stone quarrying. But when the house is built, they were never allowed, they cannot dream to go inside that house. And if that house is a school, it is even more shameful. Globally, 263 children have to be in schools, but they are not. Out of them, 63 million have never been. 263 million children must be in schools. 152 million children must be working somewhere at the cost of their childhood and freedom to produce wealth for others and goods for you and me. 50 million children are working, walking somewhere looking for a safer place tonight to stay because they have been thrown away or they are forced to leave their home countries because of wars and insurgencies in Middle East and other places. Or they were forced to leave their homes and loved ones because of the global warming, because of climate change. They have to leave the home. Their parents have to leave the home and flee from there in search of livelihoods. Whose sisters and brothers are they? Whose sisters and brothers are they? They are hers. They are ours. They are ours, children. 100 million children are facing these problems. But I have been working with the young people for the last 40 years across 144 countries. And we have seen the progress. I am very familiar and I have full faith in the power of young people in India and across the world. Hundreds of millions of young people are looking for some purpose, some path. They are passionate, they are energetic. They have much more purity and ideals than anyone else. They are unpolluted. You are unpolluted than us. Your minds are purer than us. If you are given some spark, you can become Buddha and Gandhi because the hero is inside you. I am calling for 100 million young people in the world, 100 million young people in the world to be the spokesperson, champions and change makers for those 100 million left out children in the world. We have launched this campaign in presence of 23 Nobel laureates and world leaders, including Dalai Lama. The President of India has hosted that ceremony when we launched it, and in 2 years it has grown across 35 countries. Millions of young people participating in it, young people in schools, colleges, and universities. Today, I'm not just summing up my lecture, that you respect me, you love me, you remember me, that is not needed. What I need that I am here to awaken that leader inside you. You are much bigger than an engineer. You are much bigger than a son or a daughter or a brother or sister of someone. You are above these things. Acknowledge that today and hope that you would be one of those 100 millions. Would you want to be one of those 100 millions? So slow. Raise your hands if you really want to be one of those 100 millions. Just register yourself on the website 100million.org. It does not mean, if you think that it is only for the youngsters like them, I don't believe in the age. If anyone at the age of 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 has courage to question wrongs and injustices around them, those who have courage to question, they are young. Those who have passion to find answers to those questions, they will always remain young. So all of you are young people. Raise your hands. I wanted to see how many of you feel that the world has to be just and righteous. You are a little bit slow in raising your hand. The white, blue shirt, young friend. I did not say raise your one hand. Did I say? I said raise your hands. So you are the hero, you are the hero, you are the hero. And the country, the whole world will be proud of you one day. I can assure you today in this IIT Madras. Peace. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So do we have some more time? What is the next? Is done?
Thank you so much, Mr. Satyarthi. That was incredibly inspiring. The house is now open to questions. We can take 4 questions, one from each side of the auditorium.
Here, here.
Yes, yes, please.
Sir, you mentioned about the child labor happening in Ghana of the cocoa beans. So now companies have a system of responsibly tracing back their nutrients. So they actually go back along their entire consumer chain and they try to ensure that no child labor is involved. But still, even after doing this, companies are not able to ensure that 100% of their nutrients are responsibly traced. So the number is somewhere around 60%. So why is there this huge inertia that we are not able to complete this?
Good. Another similar question? If you have a similar, anybody has similar question related to the corporations and industries, behaviors and so on? No. Anyone else? I can answer 2 or 3 questions simultaneously. Okay. This is very good question, but if you do a little bit more Googling, you will find that the man behind questioning this so-called inertia or this behavior of the big companies like Nestle, Hershey, Mars, Cadbury's, challenging them and forced to change their behavior is standing in front of you. So, I was one of the founders and initiators of the International Cocoa Initiative, which I gave up after my Nobel Prize. I gave up most of the foundations. One big reason is that there's no enough amount of consumers' awareness and concern about such issues, and it is not converted into consumers' action and demand. The secondly is that the local governments don't have that strong governance and monitoring mechanisms, and many of the officers are corrupt in developing countries. They could easily be bought. And thirdly, because of these factors, many of those big companies manipulate. They do some cosmetic work by making signs or just signing up memorandum of understandings with the local suppliers, but neither the suppliers are genuine nor those companies. But it does not mean that the progress has not been made. We have made remarkable progress in last 10, 12 years. The number of child laborers in the cocoa bean production has gone down. So some work has been done, but more is needed. But this whole idea of holding companies responsible and accountable and the consumer's power could be translated into social action has a short story. Not only in India, but it has been, this is international. Now everybody is talking about corporate social responsibility, CSR, CSR, CSR. In some places it has gone ethical practices of production. In some places, like in California, there's a law on corporate social accountability, not corporate social responsibility, and more ethical consumerism. Transparency of supply chain, this law has been also made. So I have been working on it with my local friends there. Anyway, one day I went to rescue a group of children in Uttar Pradesh, and there was a boy, 8-9 year old boy. He was not excited after freedom. All children were happy. They were, you know, desperate to go back to their homes and greet their parents. This boy was having a scar on his body, and I went close to him and I asked that, are you not happy, you want to go back home? He said, yes, but he was not smiling. One boy said that one day when he was taken here 2 years ago, when he was 6 years old, he was crying for his mother in the middle of the night. And the thekedar, the employer, hit him with a knife and he had serious injury. And since he lost all the emotions, he never smiled, he never laughed, he never cried. So I thought that I will take him back to his parents. But then one of the fathers of those boys whom we freed, who was accompanying me, he said that, sir, you don't know that his father passed away. He told me in my ear. And I was even more shocked because the boy told me that first he wanted to go and fight with his father, because why didn't he protect me, the boy told, when I was stolen from my village? And why I was sent to graze the cow or something. So I was shocked, but even I decided to take him back. I went to his village. There were other children from his village as well. The boy's name was Idris. So I asked Idris, I'm going to take to your mother. He said, yes, but also to my father. But I had no courage to tell him. So when we went there inside the village, I was asking, where is the home of Taslima? Taslima was mother's name. Then a little girl came to me and she said, don't you see, this is Taslima, auntie. I was surprised because she was looking at me, but she was not responding when I was asking, who is Taslima, the lady. The boy could not recognize his own mother. So I said, are you right? Is she Taslima? She said, yes. But then the girl told me, 6-7 year old girl, that you know that Taslima's son was kidnapped from here. From that point, she was just hinting at that point. And then the mother used to go every evening, that he is going to bring his goats back and he will come back little later in the night. So she used to sit and cry for 2 hours, 3 hours. And that went on for months. And slowly she lost her hearing and she lost her eyes. So I was in tears. And I told Idris that she's your mother. And then I shouted, I went back to this lady and I said, look, your son has come back today. So she just woke up and she stood up. The boy also somehow slowly recognized the mother. And they touched each other. As they touched, it was like an electric spark. They started crying like anything, weeping, hugging each other, did not leave each other for several minutes, 10, 15 minutes. The whole village gathered. So I was extremely happy. I felt some worth of my action that I was able to do. It happened many times, but that day was special because that day was Eid in the village, and the villagers have never seen such kind of Eid in their life. So I was sitting at the railway station in the middle of the night to take my train to Delhi. Then I found that in the same train coming from Bihar at the station called Mirzapur, about 30, 40 children came down from the bogies, the compartments. And I saw that they were all barefooted, they were all shivering in cold, they didn't have enough clothes, and it was winter night. So I started asking, and then there were two traffickers, two men who were taking them, and I stopped them, questioned them, and they laughed at me and they said, "What are you doing here? Who are you? Are you the Prime Minister of this country?" I said, "No, but these children are being trafficked. You are taking them for slavery. I won't allow you to do this." Then two policemen came, shook hands with them. They greeted each other. They know each other. All this was going on. And one of those policemen caught my hand and took me to this railway police cage kind of thing, a small police custody. So the whole night I was sitting there, it was so cold and dirty. There was no washroom, so there was a small place, 8 foot by 6 foot, the stone bench. The people who were caught there, they were having urines and other things. So it was so dirty. So I was very angry in the night. I thought that I will hold the whole world upside down. I will do every possible thing tomorrow morning, sit on hunger strike and anything possible. But because of cold or because of other things, I started thinking. I had an idea. And my idea was that let us go to the consumers, young consumers, old consumers, and educate them that, look, this is happening and this is wrong. But simultaneously, I should also go to the companies, those manufacturers who are genuinely willing to do fair business. So I approached both. So the first ever consumers campaign about any human rights issue was launched in Germany in 1990. It is not a long time, but maybe 30 years. So this was launched in 1980 in Stuttgart, and then in Berlin, and then other places, and then in United States, then London, and many places, all Europe and America. This story and these things are taught in many places, including in Harvard, because that is the first ever imagination of someone that how consumers can play an important role in changing the production and supply behavior. And as I said, that the whole phrase corporate social responsibility was not yet coined. That became a massive campaign, but I was not calling for total boycott of carpet. I was planning to introduce a monitoring and labeling mechanism, a certification mechanism, which can give a better choice, cleaner choice for the consumers, but for a better encouragement and motivation for the companies. So that is known as rug mark those days. Now it is called goodwill. Goodwill. In 1995, according to US Department of Labor study, 1 million children were working as slaves in South Asian carpet industry. India, Pakistan, and Nepal, 1 million. Now the latest figure, not very latest, but 4 or 5 years ago, the number has decreased from 1 million, 10 lakh, to hardly 200,000, 2 lakh. So 8 lakh children were saved during that time with this initiative. And that did not remain confined to carpet. The second thing was clothes, and the third thing was sporting goods. The fourth thing was the cocoa beans. And we have seen the results in all those areas, and that has become a norm now. No company can simply keep on flourishing at the cost of child laborers and slave laborers, because there are very strict rules in the world, and they are very educated consumer movements. So the things can change. So change is possible.
As students, how do you think we can play a role in reducing child trafficking and child labor?
If you go to a restaurant or a tea shop, and if a child is working, you can say no to it. That is your first contribution. If you are walking on the streets or driving and you see a child is begging, don't give any money or anything, because that is again a organized mafia operation. They steal children from one part of India and put to work in another part and force them to beg. So don't do it. If you see that any wrong things are happening, wrong things include child sexual abuse. We are ashamed or feel ashamed to learn that this hour when I was speaking, 8 children in India had gone missing. They did not disappear in thin air. They were stolen. They were sold somewhere. They were coerced. They were trafficked for prostitution, for labor work, or so on. That is the government statistics. The reality is even much bigger. 4 children this hour would be sexually abused, would have been already sexually abused in the country, or might have been raped. 2 of them are definitely raped, according to National Crime Record Bureau. Reality is much more bigger, because most of the parents or most of the young people do not complain. Most of the girls and boys, there was a report came about 10 years ago or more, that 53% of India's young people, boys and girls, are facing one other kind of sexual harassment. Stalking, bad touch, pushing in the public places, touching private part, many other kind of things in the definition of sexual abuse. That is happening with half of the people. But how many of them go to their parents and say that our uncle or our fufa, tau, jija is behaving like that, which is uncomfortable for me? How many girls do it? How many boys do it? For boys, it is much more a kind of social taboo. They are much more shy. So if you see something like this happening, break silence. Speak out loudly. If it is happening with anyone around you, speak. Because silence in these cases perpetuates violence. So if you have to stop these kind of sexual violence, break your silence. That you can do. If you see the children are being treated badly, or some unknown person is taking some children and you have some doubt, call police on 100 or call on child helpline on 1098. But you can begin by just visiting our website of this new campaign. This is not a kind of NGO driven thing. This is driven by the young people. The history has never been written by those who are silent spectators outside the ring. You can clap, great, 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 or you can criticize those who are inside the ring. But then you are not going to bring about any change. History is written only and only by those people who have courage to jump inside the ring without worrying for the lost or for the victory. They may lose or they may win, but they have courage to jump. So be the actor, be active.
Thank you for your wonderful questions. We won't be taking any more questions. Thank you, Mr. Satyarthi. I now invite the Dean of Academics, Professor A.K. Mishra, to felicitate our guest. I invite our faculty advisor, Professor Preeti Aghalyam, to present the memento. Thank you, Professor Mishra. Thank you, Professor Preeti. I now invite Ajmal Hussain to present the EML yearbook to Mr. Satyarthi, who will now sign it. EML Institutional Head Bharadwaj will now deliver the vote of thanks.
Yeah. In this journey, we've been humbled to have the first Indian-born Nobel Peace Laureate, Shri Kailash Satyarthi, here. Dear sir, your life is an inspiration to all of us. Listening to you today, we realize the importance to be change makers and strive for what our conscience tells us is right. As engineers, scientists, and social scientists in making, we'll carry forward the message of compassion into our future. It gives me great pleasure to express our gratitude for honoring us with your presence and words today. Next, I express my gratitude to Mrs. Sumedha Kailash for gracing this wonderful evening. Ma'am, you inspire us. I thank our faculty advisor, Professor Preeti Aghalyam, for our constant guidance and support in all of our endeavors. I would like to thank all faculty and their families who have come here taking time off this Sunday afternoon. I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to all the students, scholars, and others who have come here today. It's your response to our events that keep us motivated and glad. Once again, I thank you all for your time and presence. Thank you. Have a good afternoon.